Okay, we're going to get going here so we can keep relatively on time. It's private parts, no touching. So I'm Kim McGrail, and I'm one of the faculty members at the Center for Health Services and Policy Research, and I have the great pleasure of, I wouldn't say I'm ever going to moderate Colleen Flood. I don't think any of us want to moderate Colleen Flood at this point. We want the full-on, no-holds-barred call. So let me give you a bit of an introduction. Since 2014, Colleen Flood is the University Research Chair in Health Law and Policy at the University of Ottawa and Director for the Center for Health Law, Policy, and Ethics. Prior to moving to Canada for graduate work, she was a barrister and solicitor in New Zealand. She is a Fellow of the Society of Canada and the Canadian Academy of Health Sciences. She's the author of several books, I think including a new book, and highly regarded papers on health law and healthcare policy around the world. In her free time, Colleen enjoys learning French, rowing, swimming, and cooking, but although quite good at multitasking, not necessarily at the same time. Today, Colleen will talk about what options might exist for BC and Canada depending on how the court rules. Thanks, Colleen.
Okay, everybody, and thank you very much, Kim, and thank you very much to Michael and everyone here at CHSPR for inviting me out, and thank you for putting together such an amazing day already, 2 days. I'm really looking forward to it, and it's been wonderful to hear everybody and such amazing presentations so far. So I'll recap a little bit about what we've heard so far. We've heard about the Sciulli challenge in 2005, which was a challenge to the law that bans the sale and purchase of private health insurance in Quebec. But as we've heard from Damien, it didn't quite have the effect that the folks in favour of privatisation wanted. It didn't bust open a gigantic private sector or private market in Quebec or across Canada. And so those folks have come hunting again, realizing that it is not just the law that bans private health insurance that they probably need to overturn, but other laws that are protective of public Medicare, such as the law banning extra billing, the law banning dual practice, the law banning user charges, and laws that try to regulate prices in the private markets for hospital and physician services. So there are, across Canada, these laws that exist in most provinces, in all provinces, I should say, more or less passed to comply with the Canada Health Act. But it is important to note that one province has its own kind of special flavour of these. So these are sort of generalisations about what we see in each province, but there is a special mix of these regulations in each province. So in BC, just to be clear, it's more complicated because we have these three kinds of doctors. We've got opted-in doctors that can bill the public plan. They're enrolled and they bill the public plan. Opted-out doctors, they don't bill the public plan directly, but their patients can get reimbursed from the public plan. So for whatever ideological reason, they don't want to take money directly from the government, you can opt out and then your patient can still receive it. And then you have these other physicians that are completely opted out and they can bill whatever they want, right? So those are the three kinds of doctors that we have. And the provisions of the Medicare Protection Act, the one that bans private health insurance is pretty straightforward. That's similar to what you see in a number of other provinces and similar to the one that was struck down in Quebec. But the provisions about dual practice and extra billing and user charges, they're all kind of mushed up in Section 17.1 and 18.3. And by the way, mushed up is a technical legal term that BJ will explain later. So the smushed up effect basically means that physicians, whether they're opted in or they're opted out, they can't bill more than they receive from the public plan. And so this is the problem for Cambie Surgical Services and other private clinics. Their basic problem is that their physicians can get paid from the public plan the overhead that they want to run the clinic, right? And this is why their economic viability depends on them winning this case to some extent, because they can't get the overhead to pay their nurses. Well, if they do, they have to take it out of the they receive as a physician that they're paid from the government. If you see what I mean? So that's what their main concern is, the fact that they can't get this overhead and they can't make more profit by being able to charge this extra amount. Now, this is troublesome because trying to maybe achieve perhaps a small thing, which is for them particularly to get paid this overhead, they're shooting to strike down all of these provisions that strike down extra billing, that strike down dual practice generally, that strike down user charges. That's sort of wibbly-wobbly saying, well, you know, we're not really after this, we're really after striking down dual practice, but what will happen is that all of this will be struck down, it won't be half done, the law will be struck down, and it will be sent back to the government to decide what to do. So it will depend on the stripe of how they react if they are successful. So it may not be this calibrated thing that they're trying to argue in court. Well, we're not really after extra billing now. We're just after this dual practice thing. But it's dangerous stakes that we're talking about because it will depend on the reaction of the government. So this is what we call in constitutional parlance a dialogue, right, between... Stop laughing, you two. Dialogue between the legislature and the courts, right? So the courts may say something, they may overrule a particular, then it's up to the legislature to respond. They can bring in new laws, it's not the end of the game. And then it may go back again. So we're seeing this with medical aid and dying. The courts have spoken again, saying you didn't go far enough on certain ways, and so the government is having to respond again. So we have this kind of back and forth. And most likely this is what we're going to see here too if they win in some or whole. Okay, so we've heard this fantastic panel previously about what happens in other jurisdictions. And this is a key evidence gap. It's a key part of what's been heard and needs to be determined to figure out whether or not the laws are compliant with Section 7. So the court wants to hear about when it's considering whether or not the laws are quote-unquote arbitrary or overbroad, is they will reflect on whether other jurisdictions are doing similar things. And the story that Cambie wants to tell is, of course, well, we are, you know, weird, odd, strange, in league with Cuba, North Korea. There's nobody else in the world that does it like we do. And so thus, these laws should be overturned. And I think Sarah put it brilliantly in something that I keep trying to convey as well, is that this is incorrect, basically, that private health insurance acts in many different ways. It has many different forms. It performs many different kinds of jobs. It's not one thing. It has a lot of different roles across different countries. And so we need to figure out that as we look around the world. So we have been working, funded by CHR, to assess how different countries regulate the public-private divide around the world and looking at some of these questions. So I talked about the... what will come next? So what will happen if Cambie wins on one or more of their claims, overturning one or more of these laws? And I think, you know, I'm hope that they don't win, but I think it's ridiculous not to imagine that it's not a distinct possibility. And then it's even more ridiculous not to plan for that as the BC government and the federal government and other governments across this country. And I don't think, even if they lose, that this will be the end of the game. There will be other contenders that will come forward to try to achieve this market one way or another. It's just too tempting, I think, particularly if we are not able to do anything and to improve wait times, too sweet. So are we on this airline are kind of going down, or are we going to magically pull it up, or what's going to happen here? So when we're thinking about the kinds of laws that we have in place, price regulation, bans on extra billing, bans on dual practice, I think it's important just to sum up a little bit that our broad aim is to achieve access of need. So that's what we're going for. That's a goal of equity, right? And I'm going to be really interested to see how the court kind of responds to this sort of overarching objective. But then more pedantically and sort of pragmatically, health services research perspective, as Jerry was alluding to, we want to prevent the siphoning of healthcare professionals from the public to the private tier. So that's an important goal of whatever we have in place. We want to make sure that we don't have healthcare spending going through the roof. So if we have a flourishing private tier and we have to pay higher and higher prices to maintain labor in the public sphere, right, we're likely to see overall cost increases with not much benefit. So that's another goal that we have. We may be worried that poor services are poor services for poor people are poor services. Right, so we may be worried about diminished political support for public Medicare if we allow two-tier system. And we may be worried that there will, in fact, be longer wait to the public system because there may even be incentives for physicians to drive up wait times in the public system in order to fuel demand for their more lucrative private practices. So those are some of the, I think, genuine concerns that there are. And so if we were to permit some measure of two-tier healthcare, then we would want to attend to those. So if they win, these are still things that will be of concern. We will need to figure out what would be an appropriate, adroit regulatory response that will give the court what it wants, some measure of two-tier healthcare, and I call it two-tier, even though some people don't like that, too bad, and achieve our policy objectives, right? Because those policy objectives are all still there. So how do we do that? So one of the things which Stephen has already talked about, which is kind of the nuclear, is the notwithstanding clause. And, you know, whenever I talk to health services researchers and health economists who really get very passionate about anything, really, do they, Morris? But on this, they, you know, like, they're nuclear. They're like, of course we should do that, you know, notwithstanding. And I'm like, oh, God, it just sounds not an idea. And it really isn't much of an idea. We tend not to, BC has never done it, as far as I know, evoke the notwithstanding clause. And the trouble with it is I don't think it's actually going to solve the problem, because if they win constitutionally here on the charter, it will have a heavy press effect in all the other provinces who may not have governments in control that will be as desirous of protecting the public health care system. So one by one, they will fall, beginning with all the conservative-led provinces. So I'm not sure that's going to really save us, but, you know, it's always exciting. So, the other options that we have been looking at around the world are things, what I call here, demand-side incentives. So a demand-side incentive, one of them that we already have in place is the ban on private health insurance, so to basically stop people buying private. So if we move down our kind of rung of options from there, another option, which my friend and colleague Sherry Gleed thinks is a great idea, and she's kind of actually tried to promote a version of that in US Obamacare, is tax it heavily. So cross-subsidize, you know, this is the model in Saskatchewan as well. You kind of cross-subsidize private health insurance to help others back in the public tier so you can try to improve access. So that's another possible option. And as I mentioned, this the U.S. Obamacare plan was to tax these so-called Cadillac plans. So that's an example of this, right? So these are some options. What we also see around the world is something called like a ban on combined billing. So this was quite interesting. In Japan, they had a law that was also subject to constitutional challenge that said, if you want a new expensive oncology drug or device or service that is not funded by the public plan, you can have it, but then you have to pay for all your care yourself. Right? So you can't have it in the public plan and have this private part on top of it. You have to go wholly private. And as I mentioned, that was actually upheld by the Japanese Supreme Court. And then the last is the one I'm just going to come to in a minute, is to say, okay, Dr. Day, you've been talking about countries like Germany and the Netherlands and all these kinds of countries. Well, interestingly there, in a number of those countries, where they do have private health insurance, it isn't just to cover queue jumping, you have to cover it, you have to cover everything. Right? So if we are to permit private health insurance, one option is that we say you can buy private health insurance, but if you do buy private health insurance, it has to be for everything. Right? You have to opt out of the public plan. You can't sort of skim along and have your cake and eat it too. Now, so the other option, which I think is going to be much more of an appealing option, as we've heard from the sort of global trot around the world, particularly for conservative governments, is to win over the middle class and higher income people and basically subsidize the purchase of private health insurance. Right, so you could try to make it not, which is what we've been trying to do, but the other option is to try to make it more and more attractive to subsidise it. And we've heard the stories already of Ireland and Australia, so I won't rehearse them again, but I do love this particular headline that health insurance is like putting lipstick on a pig. That's got to be one of the best lines I've seen for a while. And I just want to point out then this issue around the possibility of telling people that they should, if they want private health insurance, knock yourself out, but you need to buy it for everything and not just for queue jumping. So these countries, Germany and the Netherlands, are often referred to, you know, by Dr. Day and folks in favour of privatisation. If only we were more like Europe, it would all be rainbows and ponies. And I'll just give the example of Ireland, which is a country I've studied a fair bit. And when you look at it, it looks like it's all private health insurance. Everybody has private health insurance. That's because private health insurance is the public plan. It's a mandate. You have to buy private health insurance, but it's progressive because you pay a percentage into a pool, and then that is assigned to the insurer that you pick. Right? The whole thing looks private, but it's actually public, as you saw from Sarah's representation. So it's a crock of crap that this is an example of two-tier healthcare, which is a high-performing system compared to our healthcare system. You know, how terrible we are. We should be more like that if only we had two-tier healthcare. Well, maybe we should have a system like that, but that won't happen from unbuckling the laws that we have under challenge in Cambie. Right? Now, some supply-side disincentives, I'll be brief here, are things like national fee schedules. So a number of countries have fee schedules that once you agree to them, you can't charge anymore. Right? Basically, you can't extra bill anymore. And even within the United States, in their major public plans, remember, these guys have more public dollars per head than we do here. They spend more tax dollars per capita than we do here. Two huge public plans, Medicare and Medicaid. Medicare prevents extra billing on top. So we would be even worse than the United States if we wind up going down this route. Now, another way that they do things in some countries is to restrict dual practice by way of category of physician. So by this I mean they say some physicians who are, you know, very experienced, they may operate in the private sector, right? So they try to limit the number of physicians and the number of physician hours by category of physician. And the example that I have here is what they call Sector 2 physicians in France. And so these are kind of like the creme de la creme of the grading class. Certain numbers of physicians are allowed to be sector two, and they're allowed to extra bill whatever they want. But not all physicians are sector two. And they thought at first that this would create competition and that there would all be, again, rainbows and ponies, but it didn't work out like that. So that's one way of doing it. And then another way that we see in a number of jurisdictions, and I think, you know, this is a possibility, is to contract with physicians about the amount of time that they work as between the public and private spheres. And so you see, historically, this has been the approach in the UK to sort of say, you know, you have to work 8-hour days and when it's going to be, et cetera, et cetera. And if you're on a three-quarters shift, you know, how much time you should spend in the public hospital. And what I think is very interesting about this is physicians may want to seriously think about here, though, is over time, those contracts really evolve from being just about the amount of time spent in the public and private sector to be also about the quality of the work that they are doing, measuring quality and output and performance and all these sorts of things that our guys are really so keen on as a means of oversight. Right? So you might want to be careful for what about what you wish for, but this would be another approach, which would be to try to introduce contracts between the BC government and the doctors, dictating the amount of time. If they want to work in the public system, this is the amount you have to spend in the private in the public system before you go private and knock yourself out. And by the way, we're also going to have these other expectations about quality and safety and wait times maybe and performance. All right, so these are all possible options. So what really are our options then? I've given you some of the snippets that we've reviewed from different kinds of countries. I think for me, the first option, the best option, is fixed wait times, really. And I know that a lot of health services researchers worry about resources and shifting priorities and these kinds of things. The reality is, if that wait times are not fixed, the kind of consumer element and the guarantee or the bargain between the public and governments about healthcare is out the window, right? There has to be some consumer element to our experience with the healthcare system. And I think wait time guarantees are the best way to go, the best and quickest and fastest way to achieve that. And I don't think it actually needs a whole lot of money for reasons that we can discuss at some point. The second option would be say, okay, have private health insurance, knock yourself out, but it's got to cover everything. Right? Not people would go for that, but I think it would be a reasonable response from the government to say that. You've been talking about all these countries where that is actually the option. Right? So why not? Then you could liberalize private health insurance only for those services with long wait times. That is what then Health Minister Couillard did in Quebec, at the same time putting in a wait time guarantee, and that was their response post-Quebec. Although it would seem to me that if you were going, you know, if we're worried about supply, where there are long wait times, we are worried about the supply of services normally, right? We don't have enough physicians necessarily or enough nurses to do the work. So the other, I think, rational option would be to liberalise private health insurance for services where we have an ample supply of physicians in the public, which I'm not sure where that is. But there may, you know, we do hear the odd story of new physicians not able to find positions. So that may be where we go. And then the other option is to embrace private health insurance, right? Embrace it as a substitute which we see in Ireland and Australia, and, you know, enjoy that. We will have fun from a policy and regulatory perspective, if nothing else. Then, from the perspective of dual practice, again, I think the answer is a wait time guarantee. That's we need to solve wait times. Pouring more money in, we don't seem to get anywhere with that plan. We've tried lots of different things. This works. We may not always like it. We'll have some dislocative the way to go with a patient ombudsman attached. Contractual restrictions on dual practice. That's another option. So we put in place a contract between the government and the medical profession, which limits the amount of time that they can spend. And if we have, you know, folks where we're in, there are long wait times, we might be wanting them more in the public system. We could limit dual practice by category of physician. So we can say that only, you know, the big old poo-bahs are allowed to go private. That's sort of the NHS response. At a certain period in your career, you're able to, similar to... And then the other option is we permit it without reservation. Right, we let it rip. Right. And all of these are options. And I think the question for government is to reflect on these options, to consider these options, whether they're NDP or... what's the other one? Conservative, and figure out how they will respond and what the cost and consequences will be. We've written a book. The stuff is pretty much like that picture, so that's why we put that picture on the front. Hopefully it'll be out there. And I've even finished with 5 minutes to spare. Where is Michael Law? I want to be thanked. There we go.
Share when I'm right in front. Okay, so I'm assuming the questions are going to come up here. There we go. Okay. Okay, so what I'm learning today is that I need new glasses. So we'll start at the top here, Colleen. So BC is currently having private.